un petit pex. Moi, je suis petit pex. Et j'ai fait un grand livre sur le sujet d'Andy Warhol et sa fille, sa propre fille et ses arts, son art. I'd like to. It's a fictionalized, as I say in English, it's a factual fairy tale. So it's at the same time it's a sort of fairy tale. It's a fantasy, but I use all the facts in it, and it consists of 10 parts, and they're all made to look like magazines from the era where the story takes place in. So, for example, in the 60s, things look really 60s and really flashy, psychedelic colors and all that. And when the mood changes, when it gets more grim, then the art also gets more grim. And so I hope that will make it more that the public will get more into the atmosphere if everything looks, and you don't have to explain, we're in the 60s now or we're in the 80s now, because you see it if you look at the images. It's a big book. It's a big book, and I advise the public to read it in small portions. Take one of those little books, those chapters, and read the other one the next day, just like you see a TV series. Don't go watch all of the season, then you ruin the fun for yourself. Like everybody, I was always aware of Andy Warhol and of his art, mainly. And before this, I did another book on Rembrandt, and that was a commission by the Rijksmuseum, and that's in Amsterdam, the museum that holds all the paintings of Rembrandt. And that was really a challenge to do, but when I finished that, I thought now I'd like to do something that's closer to my world. And the period that Andy lived from the 1930s to the 1980s, that's a period when everything I love in pop culture started. Like when he was born, there were still silent movies. And when he died, the first rave parties were starting. So that's a whole era of pop culture. And that was actually before I dived into his life. The first thing that attracted me was this whole, the 20th century, the start of pop culture, because that's the culture I grew up in. And when I got into his life, I saw that all his roots are also in pop culture, but he sort of gave pop culture a new face. And he made it into art, and he made art into pop. So, yes, and then we're not even speaking of his personal life, which is also, which takes up maybe the greatest part of the book. And he's such an intriguing and mysterious character that I thought, well, I make it, you don't have to love him, but I want to understand him. And through understanding also came love of this character. So those are my two options to transpose the love I have for this period of time, for pop culture, and I grew to love Andy as well. When I started Rembrandt, to work on Rembrandt, people said, aren't you afraid that you're now doing such a great artist? Aren't you sort of, you know, have an anxiety from, oh, am I good enough to do all this? And I thought, I never had this, because I was not trying to make a new Rembrandt painting. I was trying to do a comic about Rembrandt. And he may be a great painter, but I think he's a lousy comic artist. So I was never afraid to do that. And I have the same with Andy. I'm not trying to make an artwork in his style. I'm trying to do something in my style. That's why I call these books, Andy's book is called T-Pex's Andy, and the Rembrandt book is T-Pex's Rembrandt. It's my impression that I have of him as a person and my impression of his art. I wanted to start off the book. When you first have an image of the book, it looked like a packet of washing powder. And the special edition is even worse because you have to tear it open. But if you, I like to sort of guide the audience. So first you get this and you think, what is this? And you open it up and then it's sort of repetition of the first thing. So if you start a movie, you have to start with the audience, and the audience consists of Andy in all the stages of the book. So from his first youth, it goes on and on to his last days on Earth. And also the public is prepared that it's going to be in different styles. And just like in a movie, then you get a title, like big on the screen. Andy, ta-da-ta-ta, and the title music. And another preparation, now you see what you're up to. You're getting to see 10 different chapters, but you also get to see 10 different books. And I advise the public to read one at a time. So then we have the title page, and it's very small, but it's dedicated to my mother. And it says, "Ah, Mama," it's for all the mothers in the world, of course, but especially for mine. And because Andy's mother is also very important for him. But then I always like to start a book in a sort of mystery. I like it in movies too, not introduce everyone, but keep the mystery for a little bit more. So what you see, I'll have you preview the next page. His mother, Andy's mother, is reading the comics out to him, because in that time that Andy grew up, comics were so important in the newspaper, and they had this, on Sunday they had this full, this whole page of color comics, those big, and they had, the comic section was, at one time it was, I think, 36 or 40 pages in a newspaper, so it was more like you had a sort of news section in a comic paper. And these are all characters from the era where he grew up. So they're all kind of familiar comics icons. Like here you see Mickey Mouse, you see Donald Duck, but they're acting out the film King Kong, because this is the Empire State Building. You have Mae West, and the Coca-Cola bottle was then called, was modeled after her figure, like not a really small taille, no, but she was big on all sides. So that was how the Coca-Cola bottle was born. And you also see already the Campbell soup, because where Andy grew up in Pittsburgh, it was all industry, and Heinz, Betty Boop. But the only thing is, you can't read it, because it's in the old language that Andy's parents speak. It's called Rusyn, and it's a very small language which hardly anyone understands. And it's, this has all been translated by Rusyn people I met in his birthplace. And so it's 100% authentic Rusyn, but nobody can read it. But here you see America, we can all read that. And it's above it, you see all these poor people looking down, and they're obviously not from the United States, they're from the old country. And they all look over the rainbow to this wonderful world of glamour, which they all know from the movies, but they will never reach it. Above you see Maria, of course, she's very important. But if you look at all the glamour and all the American stuff, if you go all the way down, there you see where these poor people from the old country all end up. They all end up in the same line of work, the same sort of non-glamorous life. And and here all the texts are not really telling a story. For example, Dick Tracy, a big comic hero of those days, is watching at his special wristwatch, and he says, "Beddy time, children." So that's how the story starts. A couple of years, I think 4 or 5 years ago, I came for the first time in Angoulême, And it was so different from everything I ever encountered in Holland, what Comic Festival, it's so big. But the most important thing for me is that it's such an easy way to meet all the publishers from everywhere, even from the United States, from everywhere in Europe. And they're so easy, approachable, and you have this place where they sell the foreign rights. And if you just hang around there, and you're bound to meet someone. But it's even better if you go to the Café Le Chat Noir, because everybody comes there. And then, you know, then it's people who you can't never reach, impossible, even through email or make. Then you just see them and they offer you a beer. So for me, it made a huge difference. And my international career, or sort of career, started in Angoulême, that's for sure.